What we're going to do tonight is talk about the hardest subject that we really deal with here in the shelter. And I know this meeting came together because of a particular dog that a lot of you do and love. And I thought a lot about how much time of this meeting do we want to spend talking about Alfred, the dog that was just killed for behavior here at PAC. And I want to give you an opportunity to ask questions about why the decision was made and how that process for that particular dog worked and didn't work. But what I'm not going to do is stand up here and defend the decision we made to kill a dog, because I will never defend those decisions. It is very rare that I believe that a dog is inherently dangerous, inherently, definitely going to harm people or animals. But nonetheless, we make these decisions several times a week. I got this question about, I saw your presentation about, from Austin about your protocol, and you're doing exactly the opposite here. And why do you suck so bad now? You are so cool. And I really get that. And I want to just say really briefly about Austin. That city had the same intake as we do. We had one rescue partner called Austin Pets Live that every year took the 500 most behaviorally at-risk dogs out of our shelter. So I'm really proud of the work there. We saved 98% of the dogs that came into the shelter my last year. I'm really proud of the work we did, but we had a really profound partnership that made that work easier. And why it made it easier is because we have dogs that have demonstrated aggression, some that has caused harm, some that haven't. And those dogs need more intensive rehabilitative support. And many times they need to get out of the shelter because they truly can't safely be handled in a shelter. It doesn't mean those dogs necessarily need to die, but what Austin Pets Life had was a comprehensive rehabilitative program. The dogs went to play group every day. They did the Canine Good Citizen program. They had lifetime behavioral follow-up for those dogs. Anytime their owners had an issue, they could come back for help. And they had a matchmaker counseling process that was a lot more thorough counseling process than we have here. That is no excuse, because we can certainly do better. And the next time Alfred comes around, I sure hope that we in this room have worked together so we don't kill that next Alfred. But we have challenges here that I did not have in Austin, where we were saving 98% of the dogs. And so we are implementing a version of the protocol I did there. If you haven't seen the webcast, it's called Life and, we'll send out the link. It's about life and how we make life and death decisions. But nonetheless, I want to tell you, I just want to frame this in a bigger picture before we talk about any specific animals. And also tell you that I am so sorry to those of you who advocated for that dog and feel like you were hurt. And I take responsibility for that. A lot of the mistake that was made was that we didn't have this meeting before Alfred happened. We probably would have saved him had we done that. This list of 18 dogs are all of the dogs that have been killed for behavioral reasons since February 1st here at PAC. All of them, all their names, these are decisions that our team is making about 3 times a week. And it always surprises me, because I kind of go home, you know, behavior dogs are like my thing. They're why I do this work. They're like really where my heart's at. And I go home every night, and I have tears over many of these dogs that I've met. None of these dogs are really less savable than Alfred was, but they're dogs that you don't see, because they're typically coming in with known histories of aggression towards humans or animals. They've hurt a person or an animal. And so you usually don't hear about them. Some of them have been deemed dangerous. Most of them just weren't managed well. They're like roaming around a neighborhood, allowed to run around and bite somebody on the ankle. So all of these dogs represent to me the larger problem that we have. Our team has to do a better job of getting information about these animals to you so that we can start to save more of them. And we have to save them in a way that is really responsible. Because when we make these decisions, we have to ensure that we're fully disclosing the history of these animals to the public. And I'll talk more about that in a minute. This isn't all gloom and doom, though, because there's some really good news. We implemented this new procedure for making life and death decisions for behavior February 1st. And since then, One, two, three, four, five, six, seven dogs have been saved that would not have otherwise been saved because we used this pilot process to make life and death decisions. So this is a terrible list, but it's seven dogs smaller than it would have been 2 months ago. I'm gonna pass around a binder now. These are the euthanasia approval forms. I'm really comfortable with the language of killing. People ask, what do you mean kill versus euthanasia? In Austin, we use kill to mean any time an animal was dying that it wasn't truly medically suffering with no hope of recovery. And that doesn't mean it has to be used pejoratively against staff, but it's not a term we're uncomfortable with. So I use those interchangeably, but when I'm talking about non-medical euthanasia, I do mean killing, sending an animal's life that was not medically suffering. This is the binder of all the animals that have died since February 1st. And it shows you the steps we took on the protocol before those animals died. And I'm gonna walk you through each of the steps we take. I'm gonna pass this around tonight. If it doesn't get to you tonight, this will be available for review. Anytime you're at PAC, we're gonna keep this binder on a desk and you can review these notes about the dogs when you're at PAC. And we ask that you do that at PAC because we don't want to, this is not stuff that needs to be, these are just the forms that we use for approval. So we'll ask that you come and sit and review them anytime you want. They'll be with Mary Ellen, myself, or Tamsin. So I'll pass these around now. If you, everybody have this document? Okay. So here's how the approval form is gonna look. The identifying information of the animal will be up top. And then the actions taken. And this gets a little complicated, and I'll tell you why. You don't take every action for every dog. It really depends. There's some dogs that we will just make calls on. So in Austin, if we had a dog that had done something really terrible and had free roaming, gone, and mauled a person, even though there's an action taken that says plead to the fosters and volunteers, we may make the decision for public safety not to feed that animal to fosters and volunteers. But that is done in some cases. But if we don't do that, we note it on the form. The first step is medical evaluation. This is probably the hardest part of all of this. We know that some animals act aggressively because they're in pain. Did anyone hear of the dog Neville? He was a really famous dog in Austin, and he was available at an adoption center. A child ran up and grabbed him, and he bit the child on the face, and it was on video. He was sentenced to death by a court of law in Texas for this act, and Austin Pets Alive decided to fight it. They fought it in court, and they won. The dog was saved. What was really interesting about that is after he was, as part of him being saved, they had to do a full medical workup and to see if there was anything going on with him medically. And even though he was 3 years old, he had severe advanced hip dysplasia and was in a ton of pain. So when that child grabbed him, of course he turned around and bit the child. We don't do medical evaluations to that level, and we didn't in Austin either. Although probably in 3 years we'll all be sitting here and the medical evaluations will be much more sophisticated. What we do check are teeth. We want to know if they have broken teeth. Have any of you ever had a dog with a broken tooth? I've had a broken tooth. It's horribly painful to have a nerve exposed. So that's something we check on. We feel for any obvious body pain. With really unsafe to handle dogs, we have had trouble doing that medical evaluation without them being sedated. So it is not a perfect science. Step two is plead to owner or finder. One of the changes we've made is that we are going to let people know if their dog is gonna die here. Their dog is gonna die for behavioral reasons. We don't believe they have some wonderful right to not know that information. The dog's owner should know that information about the dog and have an opportunity to save it. And same for the finder. If someone finds a dog and that dog is going to lose its life here for behavioral reasons, we're gonna call the finder and alert them as well. when we piloted this in Austin, we saved like 10% of the dogs this way. Owners and finders found solutions and we helped them do it. Sometimes they wanted to take the dog back, and we worked, Adam is here for a reason. He's the chief of animal protection. We worked closely with our animal protection officers to say, here was the situation this dog was in, here's what happened. Can we offer this person behavioral support so they can take the dog back? And in some cases we said yes and some no. Plea to fosters and volunteers. I think that when I look back on this situation, the Alfred situation, based on what I knew, I didn't feel comfortable doing SDR, short-term rescues, pulling him to rescue. Some of what was, I think, not well documented were things the staff dealt with that I knew about, and that's on me. This really, truly, we failed you in communication. But we, in most cases, will plead to fosters and volunteers. And what that means is if we plead to you, but we're not SPRing, it means we are giving you the opportunity to find an outcome option. So if any of you did see my presentation, you probably heard about a dog named Gua. He had been used as a sick dog to attack people. He was in our custody in Austin for like 8 months in a kennel. He was like the saddest animal ever. So scared in the shelter, so sweet with all of us, didn't show any dog aggression, but he had literally been used as a sick dog to attack people, and we didn't know his trigger. The court ordered that we could find him placement. He went through a dangerous dog. They ordered that we could hearing. They ordered that we could find him placement. We decided as a team there was no way that we were going to release him to the public, because how could we ever know he wouldn't do this again? We found a sanctuary in upstate New York. It's still to this day the only sanctuary I've ever found to place behavioral dogs at, where I think that they get humane care in my entire time doing this work, and they're full. We sent him up to upstate New York where we get regular updates on him, and he's doing great. But that's an example of, even though we pled to volunteers and fosters, we wouldn't have sent that dog out to a foster home. We would have just said no. Because at the end of the day, on some of these safety calls, someone has to make them, and we felt like that dog was truly unsafe. Incident notes confirmed. This is an area where I think we're gonna actually really need your help. In my last shelter, we had staff support, so we assigned a staff detective to every dog. And that person had to track down all the notes, they had to meet with our animal protection officers, they had to meet with the behavior team. Every week they met as a team to talk about each case, and we really tried to figure out what happened. Because if any of you have ever confirmed incident notes, when people are in crisis, they say different things than when they're not in crisis. And that can be just like a 24-hour period. One time my dog and I got attacked by another dog. We were like on a walk, and I called 911, and to hear me calling 911, you wouldn't think like I was being murdered, the dog was being killed. And you know, an hour later, like there were no puncture wounds. We were walking along, my dog had some saliva on it. But to hear me in that moment when I was really afraid, I gave a really different account of that situation. And so we need to start confirming those incidents after the incident happens, and I'm sure Adam just confirmed this happens, that when people are upset or fearful, they're giving different information than they might otherwise give.
We actually just had a recent one where an officer went out with three dogs, attacked this woman's poodle, and killed her. So officer picked up the three dogs, brought them in there, was assigned to an investigator for a dangerous dog, and when she reached out to the owner, come find out she didn't see what killed them. Just these three dogs were running loose on the street. Or was it them, was it not them? However, she initially assigned blame to these animals without having proper proof. And in that situation, we actually returned those three dogs back to the owner. Otherwise here, they would have been dangerous if that information was found.
We are going to need some volunteer help with that. It can be a really time-intensive process, and it takes somebody with a thick skin, like a social working type person, to do those calls. And we will work with animal protection. Sometimes we can call victims. Sometimes victims really don't want to be contacted again, and we have to respect that too. But because animals are silent, we have a responsibility to make sure that what we're hearing is actually true. And we have found that oftentimes secondhand accounts are not. So each of these is going to have a date and notes attached to them. And as you look through these that we are doing in the binder now, keep in mind that Tamsin has just started this process and we've got a long way to go in terms of perfecting it. We are just beginning. We're just headed down the road of getting this process where we want it to be. So the next category is that we have people, you have to list a reason for euthanasia. And it can be one or more of these reasons, but we're doing this for the purposes of data collection. After we do this for a year, we want to be able to show through data what the biggest reasons that animals were dying were. That matters because we can start to tackle things by reason. And so those categories have to be checked. If you go to your report from last month, from February, your animal services report, the data report, we've added a report into that that is reasons for euthanasia. You'll be able to read. And interestingly, the last year, dozens and dozens and dozens and dozens of dogs were being killed for aggression. Quote, aggression, without any real like explanation of what that meant. That won't happen anymore because animals are only going to die for documented incidents. So I think those were based on the old school temperament testing, which we know through science now is not predictive of future behavior, that we have stopped doing here at PAP. And lastly, we have form completed by a manager has to review the form, and then myself or the deputy director have to sign off on each one. So Sarah or I signs off on each of these. Because at the end of the day, many of you heard me earlier this week lamenting that so many of our staff were being called names, feeling badly, feeling like this something was their fault. At the end of the day, the buck stops with us. We're the ones that make these most critical of decisions in the shelter. But we do it with a team. What I can promise you is that, and I promised you the day I started, was that animals weren't going to just disappear and you weren't going to know what happened to them. We were going to give you some heads up, and so that you didn't have to find out that your favorite animal died after the fact. In this case, and I think moving forward, what we need to do, what I need to give you all now, is a longer window. I think you need at least, what I'm going to propose is that for every animal that you know, that we feel like this animal can't keep living in a shelter and we don't have an outcome option, we're not comfortable SPRing it, I think we need to give you 72-hour window, 3 days, which by the end of the 3 days, you need to have an idea about an outcome option. Because I fear a little bit what will happen is people say, oh, well, we can do rehabilitation in the shelter and we can have a trainer come in. The problem with a lot of these dogs that I think are going to be at risk as we move ahead that you know, is that we really need to get them out of the shelter. They need to get out of the shelter because they're truly not safe being handled in the shelter. And so if we give you a 72-hour window to look at options, we tell you what options we'll consider. So like on the worst case scenario, we may say sanctuary only. If it's an animal that's truly a toxic person, cause harm, we may say sanctuary only. And as I just said, it's really hard to find sanctuaries for dogs where they're treated humanely. On most dogs, we would open up the option of a trained foster. We need trainers in this community to help us foster animals. We could be fundraising right now to get some local trainers, pay them to foster an animal for 4 days so we know if they're an animal. There's a lot we can be doing that we're not doing yet. And I think as we start to do it, not only will we not be killing the Alfreds, but we won't be killing all of these dogs either. Because there are certainly dogs on this list that were just disabled. Mm-hmm.
Are we notifying the dog?
Yeah, so that's a great question. The question is how we notify people that the 72 hours have begun. So we had, not all volunteers wanted to be involved in this in my last shelter. And I don't think we have it here, but we had a dogs at risk group. We did it through Yahoo. But we had a group of volunteers that asked to be notified and asked to be part of this process. And we felt it was important to give people the opt-out option, because some people who come here do not want to know that stuff is happening. And the Dogs at Risk group was also a place where people could talk about those dogs. The Yahoo group was a discussion forum and a notification forum. I propose we do something similar so that the people who really want to help save these dogs, or at least want to have the knowledge, will get it at the time that they need to have it. Does that seem doable to everybody in this room?
Gina?
Yes.
You think we could do that? I don't know if we'd want it to be a Yahoo group, because I think those are kind of like old and I don't even know how to use them. Maybe like a Google group? Yes.
A new page.
No pages. Oh. Our pages. We have like 40.
No.
Whole nother meeting.
Why not an email list?
Yeah.
Well, the thing is the reason I think an email list is good, but I know volunteers want to be able to discuss these animals and need to be able to. Right? Like, need to be able to throw back and forth options. So that's where I get a little hung up on just an email distribution, although we need that too. So that those of us filling out, once we complete the form, is when you get the information. Yes.
Okay, so we have this group set up and we're notified within 72 hours. So the onus is on us to raise enough money to save the dog in 72 hours.
It's not always, money
to find a trainer, to find an outlet, to give us 72 hours at a time to tell the volunteer.
Yes.
But I think it's just, if I understood you correctly, we don't have to have a final solution. We don't have to have the trainer in place, the funds there.
Correct.
We have to have a viable option.
Yes.
If you're going to let us work and maybe buy a little more time as long as it's progressing.
72-hour extensions as we go. So if in 3 days you think you have someone in the community to work with this dog, or we have a possible foster, and the impact staff feels like that's a viable option, then we've extended another 72 hours while we work on that option. We work on in 3 day time periods so that we can.
As long as we're making progress and looks like we're going to have a positive outcome.
Yes.
Okay.
Yep.
But the notification is after you guys have basically gone through everything you can do.
Yes.
So it's not like it's from the minute you start thinking about it. You've gone through everything.
After SPR,
okay.
If we are going to do SPR, if we are going to do SPR, it's after that. It's when we're at the end of the line.
Okay.
It's like when they're truly going to be, this is the no joke. Like,
okay.
It's happening. Yes.
All right.
Yes.
How could you know what dogs approaching that 72 hours? That's one of the things that happens to me. Dogs that are kind of on, that can go either way. But people, that we know. I know some people are between each other, but there's some way that we can know which dogs are kind of that maybe that we can
that's a really great question, and it's why we have Patricia here, who's going to be working that behavioral foster program for us. She's going to be working backwards off the long stay list, but the dogs that are experiencing behavioral decline need faster intervention here. And I think we haven't been great at that because we're just so darn busy, and all of a sudden they've been here 120 days and we're like, what? We need to work together on that, and if any of you were at that Orange Dot meeting, we need to catch the dogs before they get to this point so that they can go into this Orange Dot program and never get here. So I think we have some proactive work. It's a really good point that you bring up.
Yeah, I don't know if you guys have all met Patricia yet. She is the new adult dog foster coordinator. Fortunately, she's commuting to and from Phoenix on a daily basis right now. So
she needs a place to live.
she's already, you started to see probably some of her posts on the volunteer page and things. Today she sent a video of a dog that I don't think you've been here that long.
Eve.
Is it Eve?
Yeah. Oh no, the dog that hasn't been here that long. Yeah.
That's jumping, spinning, crazy in the kennel. Like, that's a thing. that immediately, as soon as you see that, that dog will be trained. And so she's been doing rounds with the behavior team and the clinic and the other people, and she's already spotting all those things and putting them out, just sharing that information. So she's been here 2 weeks. So as she kind of settles in and gets her routine, that kind of communication of those wobbler dogs and things that are, the behaviors that are declining are going to be better.
Yeah, I think that so the challenge too is that when we get on these deadlines, the challenge becomes communicating. And so many people were like, I was sending you emails and you weren't responding, and you're not wrong. I think we need to establish volunteer lead points of contact and staff lead points of contact. So in those most critical moments, we're making sure that the communication is getting to the right people. I may forward an email and assume it's been responded to, and it hasn't been, and then you feel like no one's listening, and oh my gosh, this is life and death. What could be more important? So I think that we have some work to do there. This is really just an initial meeting, and it was an initial meeting so that I and our team could stand in front of you and tell you that this is no one is going to tell you we think we were right. We think this dog should have died, and we're going to tell you why. It's to say that this is a terrible thing that happened. Mistakes were, of course, made, as they always are whenever a dog dies. We're always failing. And we need to do things to fix it so it doesn't happen next time.
So before you go to the
SDL, yeah, so we asked you to get chameleon training because we want you to be able to enter notes in the children's software. We need to have the notes in the shelter software system for exactly that reason. They're really important. And so if you are working with dogs that have behavioral challenges, so when we formed this Orange Dot program, which I'm hoping Larry's gonna help us start, when we form that program, a key role of those Orange Dot volunteers is gonna be entering notes into the shelter software system. Because as you can see, you all hear about the one dog, but this is what we're dealing with. We're dealing with like 5 a week that we're working through notes on. So you entering notes, I didn't just do that. You know, when I got everyone access to Chameleon, it wasn't just because like I thought that was a nice thing to do. We really need you to use it. And we're hopefully moving to a web-based software system in the next year or so, so that you can do this from home. Because I recognize what a pain in the tail to have to stop what you're doing, help any animals to enter notes. But those notes truly are life-saving.
Yes.
Yeah, but if we start a group, right, like if we have the dog, they go on risk, and we have this dogs at risk group, if we've started that group and you haven't entered your notes and you're like, oh, that would be the time that group can discuss. And I think if we have just a couple points of contact on either end, we'll make sure the information is getting to the right people.
One of the challenges I will say that we're working through with giving everyone access is county IT.
Can you speak up?
I'm sorry. Right now we're dealing with a challenge with giving everyone access to enter notes because county IT doesn't really understand the program, and they think that it's potentially harmful to all of the computer systems throughout the county. So I'm working through that right now, explaining to them what access that entails. I've been working with Josh on that. So
that's why the group is even more important and why it's something that we need to do sooner or later. It's a really great question. So Marcy asks, are we going to follow the same protocol for medical? It's more complex than that. We have a draft procedure, which we've been putting our toe in the water on for medical cases. It's very different because it involves things like distributing pain medication, trying 3 different treatments. So it's a different protocol, but it's our next step. And like you and I discussed, we're working on implementing. implementing it, but it's a pretty different protocol because the medical animals, it's typically strictly a resource issue, and there isn't the public safety. Totally amazing with some people and not others. We're gonna get into a trickier population, you guys. Like, you get into this last 10% of dogs and they do get harder and the problems get more complicated. And I think, I really believe we need to start seeking out better behavioral resources in the community. And I just met with Christy before this. We need a stronger group of trainers and truly experienced behavioral dog handlers. That are committed to using positive reinforcement. We need those people in this community helping us because there's a lot of dogs that, like, I just feel as a responsible shelter director, I need to know someone with some specialized skills is taking that dog home for at least a couple of weeks so we can get some more assessment. We know that shelter assessments don't work, but it doesn't mean we don't need to evaluate them in a home setting and learn more about how the dogs are in a real life setting. It's why playgroups are so important. Because they show us a little bit of the real side of the dog. Not a lot, but a little bit in a way that standardized temperament testing just doesn't.
There's a really last tomorrow
dogs that have behavioral challenges die first, or it's dying because we don't have the resources to save it currently available. Either we don't have an immediate placement, we don't have trainers, we don't have sanctuary. So I think, yes, certainly space is always a factor, and I'm really concerned it'll become more of one this summer. Until the construction project's done, we are full at 400 dogs. We're about to have 200 more dogs on site. So animals that can't be co-housed will be more at risk. And we're gonna have to work really hard until we move into the new building to keep those animals alive. I'm saying that any killing of a dog under the last 5% is always really about space or resources. Oh no, no. Yes, none of these, a truly dangerous dog is a very rare thing. A truly dangerous dog is a rare thing. But there are dogs that need a high level of management. One of my colleagues jokes that if it needs to go live in the woods, only be around one woman and never see any humans or other animals again, that is a high level of management. And it's a dog that most of us aren't even thinking about saving now. We have got in our community dogs that really are offensively aggressive towards other dogs. If they jump that fence and they see another dog, they are gonna run and attack it. So a lot of what's still dying. Offensively aggressive dogs who are going off their property and attacking other animals. Is that dog rehabilitatable? Probably, absolutely. But we're not there yet.
Do we have something that we can take to or send to or deliver to positive reinforcement trainers in the community that says, this is what we're looking for, this is what we need assessment on, can you help us, and how much will it cost so that we know what we have to raise as a group?
Yeah, I think Kim Silver's the only actual positive trainer in the community. Is there anybody else that is doing that work? I don't know of anyone. And why do we say positive trainers? Because there's a big debate about that. The reason I try to find positive trainers is because we recognize that most of our dogs are trauma survivors. If their only trauma is losing everything they ever knew, that's still trauma. And so to subject them to more negative reinforcement is not ideal. Many of my colleagues do it, and they save lives doing it. But we need at least mostly positive trainers. So PAC wouldn't advocate that choke chains or prong collars or shock collars be used by any of our dogs.
Well, I think balance trainers, if they know that,
So we can look for some balance trainers in the community as long as they commit to not using aversive collars and other kinds of aversive training, force-based training on dogs. And we work, there's a guy in Phoenix actually that saved a bunch of dogs for me, and he just moved to Phoenix. He's great. We need to try to find him. But he did some, he was a balance trainer, but he said, like, okay, whatever you guys say are the like lines in the sand for you, I got it. And he respected those lines in the sand and helped us save a lot of dogs.
What are you saying, balance?
Balance trainers are people who use sort of a combination of training methods.
Yeah, I've worked with a trainer that dogs, and she's not completely positive, but she never wants you to say any kind of negative positive. They can respond so wonderfully. And she would not have the 5-7. Yeah, of course.
So is there anybody looking for a trainer to train trainers?
Yeah, well, we need to bring in some national trainers. I mean, Suzanne Clothier and Patricia McConnell. There's so many people that we could be bringing into this community to help us be dog trainers. Those people cost money. To get Patricia McConnell or Suzanne Clothier or some of these other trainers into town to help work with us so we can be at a better skill level to handle some of these hard dogs, it's going to cost money to get them into town, but I think it's a worthwhile investment. They were already there doing training, so we would be like, hey, can you pop over for a day? Or we would send our people to their trainings. Has anyone hired? Probably, I'm gonna like ballpark it, 4,000 to 5,000 for a 3-day seminar. No, it's not, and you know, we could all participate. And if some of us can get our skill levels up, we can be the first 3-day foster. All I need to know from a shelter director perspective is once a dog gets into a home that they're gonna normalize. So if someone with a skill level that can handle that dog can take it for a few days, tell us how it acted, we can do step down fostering, get it into another home. we can say most of these guys. But, you know, I recognize that I, as a director, failed you. I failed you with this dog, and I fail you with dogs every day still, and I'm sorry for that, but I am also standing up here telling you I truly need your help. We need people to step up into leadership roles and say, I'm going to take on the Orange Dog Program. I'm going to help find a trainer. I'm going to help raise money. Because we are a municipal shelter, and we are trying like heck to be the most life-saving community in America, but we really do need your help. There just aren't enough of us to do it. And I think we have to do it together and move this forward together as a community, or it's just not going to work. And I know, I really appreciated the question about, but this is on the volunteers. Like, we have to figure this out. And it is a hard answer, but it is true that we are limited in resources. All of you who volunteered for PAC for years know that even 3 years ago, I don't even think we had paid adoption counselors. It was all you guys. Now we need you all to take us to the next level on these hard cases. Yes?
We need to put some soft, do this more personally. I need help with communication. I started the meeting by saying this was a large deal of problem of communication. Gina and Bonnie are very, a lot more of us than there are of them. And I'm a new guy, and I don't know what I don't know at this point, and I don't know where to go to get help. And I feel badly going by before Gina.
Yeah.
And they need more help. So one of the things that needs to happen is some sort of communication plan that pulls all of these pieces together. We have too many damn Facebook pages. Too many places to look for information, and not enough places to look for real information. And I'd want to know, frankly, a lot more in advance than 72 hours about a dog that's at risk. I worked, you had a meeting where you talked about the three groups that you wanted to start.
Yeah.
And you're working with the Orange Dog, not to sound like. I also heard you talk about long stay dogs.
Yeah.
I'm worried as hell about urban centering rate. You talked about senior dogs. I'm worried about a whole bunch of older dogs.
Yeah.
We need to get groups going. I'll help with that if I can.
Okay.
But we need to know what we need to know to do that.
Yeah. I assure you.
What would you say, Colleen, you mentioned that you must do it as a step process before STI, and you were sort of talking about that. But I think the structure would be really
important.
This is what happens when this is slant, and this is what the STR and then 72 hours, there's a couple steps before that.
Yeah.
The timing, structure. So there's plenty of time to communicate, and then there's something that's in the future. So that's really not off that often until we get to the end of the process.
Yeah.
The urgency, but more of the
yeah.
The step before that, that you're talking about, the heads up step.
The step, Marcy's saying that we need more time sort of up front, and she's right in that we need to figure out how does the behavioral foster coordinator work with Tamsin, work with any other external resources we have, work with Gina, Bonnie, myself, and Sarah to communicate with you about these animals. Adam, poor Adam, I asked to be here tonight. He's our chief officer, but he's also probably the most incredibly life-saving animal services officer I've ever worked with. He wants to save, you know, animal control's first job is to protect public safety, but Adam understands that protecting public safety is not a trade-off for saving lives. That if we do this the right way, we actually create safer communities. We create safer animals, and we give people the support they need. And I appreciate him so much even sitting here with us tonight, because he supports all this work that we're going to try to do. And that is almost unheard of, so thank you.
I think another thing that kind of goes along with that is, and a little bit about some of the volunteers thing, at no point are we going to need to say, this is not part of this process. So you know, as we approach STR assignments, I guess, or when we approach the 72-hour labels, it's there are things that happen before that. There are foster and rescue things that happen before we're stuck just on this TR. Well, yeah, depending on your business.
Well, no, just not always. You say it's a resource issue, and not always the resource is requested before it is estimated. The resources are always
behind like 5 years ago. So I don't know, Gina, if you want to take the lead and figure that out. I want to give you an opportunity. Yeah! She was raising her hand, so I thought, wait, I want to give you an opportunity to ask questions of the crew here because they stayed for this tonight. So I want to give you a chance to ask any questions you have of this crew. We have Bonnie, Gina, Sarah, Samson, and Adam representing kind of all areas of the organization. And I think I saw Rocio hiding back there in the corner. Hi, Rocio. Well, so you've got people from all corners of the organization. If you have questions for them, if you've had enough and you're like, okay, got it, please feel free to go walk dogs. But at this point, because, I mean, they're all like, guys, where are you? At this point, if you want to ask questions of the team, now would be the time to do that.
If anybody does want to leave before you guys go, we'd like to, of the crew that's here tonight, if you guys want to be on that group that Kristen's talking about, to be notified when we have this situation come up with dogs in the future, if you can please, this is different than the roll call sheet that you asked for. If you specifically want, we totally respect that there's some of you here that may not be willing or want to be involved in that part of the process, and that's totally fine. So if you do want to, I'm just going to send this around. So if you're planning to leave and you want to sign this, please do it.
We also need to know if you want to be on the red dot or orange dot program, whatever we're going
to
call it.
Should they just put a dot next to their name if they
want to? Yeah, that's a great idea. Put a dot at the end of your name.
Talking about the specialized group to help these dogs. So we're not talking about changing anything.
No, this is geared towards, it's just volunteers who are trying to stabilize dogs. So, therefore, that's something that we kind of want to start here, and it's not going to take away from other duties or add extra. It's just you're kind of focusing, recognizing, and then relaying that information. And so, like our new canine fun camp, that's going to be part of that group.
So a lot of it that you guys are already doing, it's just simply bringing it together into one focus.
So the whole idea is a group of volunteers working together on various parts of this. If you look at the whole thing, it's helping problem dogs all the way from when we start noticing the problems, getting them training, getting them into foster, getting fosters trained, there's a lot of components. Getting them all the way to rehomed and a lifelong home and offering support. So in that, if you want to be part of any of those pieces, then sign up. That's a little piece of it.
So that's part of it.
That would be under the soul.
Well, we could take Rex, for instance, and give out our numbers and be part of the adoption.
You could. And that's also something that will work out how to actually do that. But yes, that would be a perfect
example. Some of them are still listening to this. Mm-hmm. Yeah, sorry.
Yeah.
No, you guys are fine. You okay?
Yep.
Orange Dot program is like decomp for Orange Dot dogs. Like, very simply, it's like a program to catch those dogs before they become SDR, before they become truly at risk. It's to catch them, give them more support before they get to that point. And we really, really need people to help with that program.
Some volunteers are
volunteers.
Some volunteers don't want to do that.
Well, I know, but what she's saying is to be aware.
So to be on the list, to be aware of issues, to talk about behavior dogs, to try to give support, that's what you're gonna sign your name up for. If you wanna actively help those dogs, like I don't, I'm like, jumping mouthy dogs make me really nervous. I would not be an appropriate orange dog handler. I'd be like this the whole time. If you're one of those people who really wants to know but doesn't want to actually actively work with the dogs, do not put a dog next to your name. Okay, you had the next question, sorry. Yes.
I'm just wondering if there's a behavioral criteria.
Cats. We shouldn't be killing any cats for behavioral reasons. The exception to that that still happens in packs is cat, feral, semi-feral, and behavior cats with medical issues. And that's something we need to be working on, and thank you for bringing that up.
I think it would be a good idea to not have anyone that is a part of the life-saving operations team be a third signer on any of the behavioral measures. I just think it's kind of, you know, because they have such close working relationships with rescue partners and volunteers, and it's such an emotionally charged thing. I think ideally it would be great to not have them be the first just throw it out.
Yeah, one of the things that we do ask though, you know, is that they're involved in these other steps. You know, so by saying yes I did this.
Oh, I appreciate that.
Yeah. But I agree.
Can I ask an Alfred question? Human knowledge mistakes were made, which is awful. One of the biggest questions that the animals had is how many animals.
Could you restate the question, please?
Why is not a requirement to do a
question? Because I'm not busy.
Nope, they are legally required to be spayed or neutered before they have a permanent outcome. Sure, there's a lot of disputed science and research on that. Some people say that it does, some people say it takes 60 to 90 days. Some people say that it doesn't. So, yeah, spay neuter is a whole other meeting, which we should talk about. We do send unaltered animals to foster because it's life-saving. We're capacity, and it's going to get worse. If our choice is between killing for spay and sending them to foster unaltered, we will send them to foster unaltered, bring them back for spay and neuter surgery, and get them adopted because it truly is life-saving. Now, one caveat to that. We got a donor who's an awesome guy who just gave us a lot of money to hire a fourth vet and two techs. He's like the nicest man in the world, and he met Dr. Wilcox and just like fell in love with the work they're doing. With that fourth vet, it's gonna be our goal that they come off that stranglehold and they go right into spay-neuter surgery. So we're hoping to resolve this so it's not even a conversation we have, but that's why we ever make the decision to send it on all things. All right, well, that is a separate meeting. I'm answering to my best of my abilities tonight, and we're happy to talk with more with you, and it's something that we're really working on, getting them off stranglehold to spay neuter. Yes?
I just have one question. Why wasn't he given the opportunity to go as STR? Why was he?
Yeah, sure. Why didn't we plead him to SPR?
Yes.
So we have pretty limited rescue partner support for SPR, and I made the decision after speaking with Hampton, Rocio, and Dr. Wilcox, who all felt that he had a level of aggression and safety issues to humans, that they all felt really seriously concerned that he was aggressive to people. I made the decision not to put him on an SPR list because of that. And that is a decision that I totally understand that many of you may disagree with. And the reality is, at the end of the day, somebody's got to make that decision. And I made it in the case after speaking with three staff members that I trust a lot and reading his notes. And we we don't consult volunteers necessarily on decisions about life adaptive. We have.
The volunteers.
You may be able to lock him fine, but that doesn't mean that that's a safe dog. That does not translate. There are plenty of dogs in shelters that can be handled by plenty of people that still aren't safe dogs and need pretty intensive rehabilitation or need to go to sanctuary. That exists. So that isn't really a way we would have measured.
So looking to the future, would you be opposed to, once we have this group, specialized group up and running, to have input from that group about the particular dog before decisions made? Does that seem like...
Absolutely. And, you know, we did. So I think we don't want to have it be a group, but a volunteer representative. So the person that helped me develop this protocol was Nathan Winograd, who does the NOPA Advocacy Center. And he always advocated that we had a volunteer representative, and I think we need that. I think we need a decision-making body for these harder cases that includes a volunteer representative. That needs to be someone with a level head and who truly understands the public safety constraints we're under. We are a municipal shelter, and I hate the words public safety. They mean a million things to a million people, right? They're one of those really slippery terms, but those are real concerns for us. We are not a private rescue. And we need a volunteer representative who is willing to take that on, who does understand those constraints. But we are welcoming of that person being part of the decision-making process and representing the volunteers in those cases.
Yes.
Does anybody in this group actually know what the definition of a dangerous dog is in the county?
Nope.
Okay. So for those that don't know, is any dog that injures, bites, attacks, chase, or charge without provocation, or attempt to injure, bite, attack, chase, or charge without provocation a person or domestic animal in a manner which poses a threat to public safety.
What's provocation?
Provocation means someone taunting it, grabbing it, doing something to it. So, which may happen 1,000 times a day, but when you start looking at what the definition is, attempt.
Right, so if a dog's on a leash, he lunges, is that an attempt?
Who determines that? Who determines provocation? It's based off of a victim. So a victim's interpretation.
Victim
so say I'm definitely afraid of dogs. A dog runs up to me. I feel threatened by it. No matter what that behavior is, I feel threatened. That animal could be seen as a dangerous dog. We have dogs that are in the city of Tucson that are going out and chasing people that are getting deemed dangerous. So I want to kind of put this in context. So what this leadership team is doing is they're looking also at not just what's going on internally, also looking externally to what we can do with ordinances to get this change. Because if we put the letter of the law, we can just start walking down the paws grabbing dogs.
Yeah.
And that's not what we're trying to do. So we're actually working not just internally, we're working externally to get new ordinances in place that really represent when we're talking about a dangerous animal, that what I feel, what Kristen will feel, that is truly a public safety issue. And that's what we're working towards.
Everybody stop. It is 6:30. I promised this would be an hour-long meeting. If you have questions, we're going to conclude the meeting now. If you have questions for Adam, Camden, Gina, Sarah, you can come on up to the front. We'll go outside and get some fresh air. But we're going to conclude the meeting now. I really appreciate you all coming. I hope that this at least offers you some explanation about what you can expect as we move forward. Thank you.